My three kids all have their birthdays around the same time of the year, in the fall. Two of them are twins, so I guess that's how it works, but some falls in particular really feel like the start of a new chapter. I know when it comes to raising kids, things don't really change overnight all of a sudden, but sometimes it feels like it does. Right about now, my oldest just started elementary school. To adjust for the new schedule, I changed my work hours, and Deanna changed her job completely. As my twins are potty training, it kind of feels like we're at the very end of the baby years, that stretch of time where so much of our time, energy, and attention has been focused on the important and all-consuming task of keeping three small humans alive. And as we're moving out of that stage, it's making me think of all the ways that I'm different from who I was before all this. Back in 2019, when I learned I was going to be a dad, that marked a massive shift in my identity. And not long afterwards, a pandemic shut down the world, and it only reinforced that change. I stopped going to an office, I stopped traveling, boxing, a whole bunch of activities. There really wasn't much for me to focus on other than life at home. About a year later, I started to see my platform take off. I started illustrating and making videos. Reese got older, and just as the world started opening up again, we had twins. The past few years have been especially wild. I've never had more opportunities to do things I love, like speak at events or travel or go on storytelling trips. At the same time, I've also never had more demands on me at home, and I absolutely love that part of my life, above everything. But this tug of war between home and away and what's best for everybody, it's been complicated, and messy, and full of discovery. It's brought up a lot of questions about identity and what makes me, me. Now, I absolutely love being a dad. It was something I always knew I wanted out of life. I lost my own dad pretty early, and so the idea that someday I might be somebody else's dad, that was always a pretty big deal to me. Now that it's finally happened, I can say it has totally lived up to the hype I created for it. But with three kids right away in 2 years, it was so hard to do things outside of being a dad. I remember in those early months feeling like I was just stuck in a big creative rut, uninspired, unenergized. I think a large portion of where that was coming from was that all these other parts of me were just stuffed into the back seat for a good while, you know? I had to stop running, stop boxing, doing physical activity, which meant I just wasn't using my body as much. It made it harder for me to fall asleep. I couldn't travel. That was a big source of my creative inspiration. And I kind of fought to get these parts of myself back fairly early. Even though it was a stretch, I knew that would be good for me, and it would even be good for the kids. When they were old enough to travel, and by that I mean 5 months, we took our first family trip to Guatemala. Now, this is my story, but generally speaking, moms have an even harder time with this, you know? See, I think whoever you are, you're meant to be this whole complex individual with multi-dimensional identities. Whenever we find ourselves in a position of having to put ourselves into one role, behind one label, just in one position, that's when things get really imbalanced. Now, it's one thing when your life circumstances force you to ride one aspect of your identity for a season, but it's another when your whole life is like that. I think of how in our culture we tend to put a lot of emphasis on skills and productivity and career and job titles. Like, kids are extremely young when we start asking them what they want to be when they grow up. And when they do grow up, the go-to for how to introduce yourself is by your job title. But I think your best example of this is the classic case of the retired star athlete. I remember reading Todd Zielecki's biography on one of my favorite pitchers of all time, Roy Halladay. Now think about what it must be like to have an athletic skill where most of your life, you're just better at it than anybody else around you. You dominate in school, and then you go pro, and you have to work really hard to make it, but you actually do. And now you're even more famous for the skill that most people know you for. You have a great career. Then, maybe in your mid-30s, your body doesn't quite do what it used to. You're forced to retire. And in theory, you have many years ahead of you, but the thing that's always defined your life is now over. Yeah, at that point, it's really tough to get a sense of who you are now.
As you know, I'm here today announcing that I'm retiring.
I'm retiring from the NFL.
I can't believe how fast 20 years went by. I mean, this is crazy.
while we have lots of examples of athletes who struggle to make that transition, we do have some positive examples, and one of my favorites might have to be that of Niels Vanderpil, the Swedish speed skater and Olympian. So, in 2018, he kind of underperforms, at least by his standards. The following year, he has to take off from skating due to his required military service, and he realizes the reason why he wasn't performing so well was because of the intense pressure he was putting on himself. Like, he realized he was staking his entire sense of meaning and identity on his ability to skate and the results he was getting. And as he was getting older, that identity was becoming threatened. Vanderpil had been known for intense training regimens. Like, this guy has a 68-page PDF that outlines all of it. But he decided to make 2 days off part of the routine, and to take those days off very seriously. In them, he basically lived a normal life, reading, hanging out with friends. He'd even go on hikes, which is not a recommended thing physically for a recovery day. But as he got really active in his community, he started to find other aspects of his life beyond skating that were giving him a sense of meaning and identity. And it totally eroded that sense of fear he had developed. So when he shows up to the 2022 Olympics, he completely dominates.
Will it be a world record as well? It is! It's a world record! Amazing!
He shattered world records, and his new records are likely going to stand for a long time. So I love that story of Niels Vanderpil because I feel like I can relate to it, you know, being a fellow Olympic athlete and everything. No, just kidding. I landed my dream gig relatively early in life, you know? I work in climate communications for an awesome organization, and it lets me travel and meet some of the most fascinating people all around the world. It's the kind of job that from the outside looks fun and interesting and good for humanity at the same time, and you know what? It looks and feels that way from the inside too. I love what I do. I've spent my whole life just trying to make room for the things that I love, and I feel like that's been paying off these past few years. It pays the bills, and I have more time to do it. That said, it was really easy to lead off with that part of my identity. You know, Philippe the climate communicator, the storyteller. People generally wanted to know more about that, so it was an easy card to play to put myself in a flattering light. And look, there were times I leaned into that because I wanted those to lead to more opportunities to keep doing the things I love. But yeah, it also became really easy to overinvest in this part of my identity to the detriment of others. What that often looked like was riding the roller coaster of the ups and downs of work, you know, beating myself up over small mistakes when I felt like I could be doing better, I know what I'm capable of. It honestly made it harder to position myself for growth because I felt like I often had to assert myself as being at the top of my game. So one thing you hear a lot about is that when asked to introduce themselves, Americans are more likely than the rest of the world to introduce themselves by their job title or saying what they do. And there's even more to this pattern. Studies found that Western subjects are a lot more likely to describe themselves using attributes like smart or hardworking or persistent when compared to subjects from Asia, Africa, or the Middle East. They mostly used relational words, things like father, son, friend. And Americans were more likely to see their identities as fixed, which means like constant and the same across different circumstances. Now, if you contrast that with Korea and Japan, over there you saw that people were more fluid in the way they expressed their identity, that it changes depending on who you're around. You know, you might be talkative and crass among your peers, you might be more self-deprecating at work, more proud and quiet around elders. And I think a lot of people in Western settings find that sort of pivoting hypocritical, like you're a different person in different settings, you're two-faced. But most Asian respondents saw those adjustments, that ability to adjust on the fly, as a sign of wisdom. And in reality, I think we all adjust the way we carry ourselves based on who we're around. I don't show up to work the same way I do on a date or to a reunion with college friends, and the way I am around my kids is different from all of that. But being able to be at peace with that flexibility, to recognize that our identities are multidimensional, to me, that just feels healthier.
think it's not just about doing a bunch of different things that stack up on top of each other. It's more about harmony and rhythm, seeing how those different layers of identity interact. So last year, I was in Colorado and I met a beekeeper. Actually, he wasn't just a beekeeper. He was a dad, a pastor, a big game hunter, and he was about to get married. He was a little bit of everything. And it seemed like he really put his soul into all these different practices he took on. I love the way he described his life. He said something along the lines of, I'm a better dad when I'm a better beekeeper, and I'm a better pastor when I'm a better dad, I'm a better hunter when I'm a better pastor, and there was this whole harmonious relationship between all these different things he did. I started to think that, yeah, that's the sort of synergy I want in my life. I've always been attracted to doing different and diverse things, but to get them to support one another, to flow into each other regeneratively, that seems like a sweet spot. I kind of like to think of the stories I tell as the opposite of watching the news. What's kind of ironic about this is I actually wanted to be a journalist at first. I went to high school, I wanted to go to school, study journalism, and then go do badass things on the front lines of war zones, like on the field reporting. I went to school, I went to UC Santa Barbara, I got there and I discovered they had no journalism program. Like, you would have thought I would have looked this up before applying and accepting, but I didn't, so I was stuck with what do I do now? A couple years ago, I got my very best taste of this. I was invited to speak at Creative Morning San Diego, and a big thing I love about the Creative Mornings world is that the talks have some serious range. I was given the theme of depth, and so I got to explore the idea how there's always more to the story, and how this idea has proven true in my travel, in my professional work with climate, and in my own family life. And that experience, getting to share those stories, was awesome. It kind of felt like Philippe the traveler, Philippe the climate storyteller, Philippe the dad, even a younger Philippe from 15 years ago, all got to have some stage time and jam together. It felt cool and complete. It felt a little bit like what that beekeeper, hunter, pastor, dad was describing. I think our identities might be a bit like forests or gardens. You know, there are different seasons, but these things are the healthiest when they're the most diverse. Simply relying on only one species to grow is not gonna set you up for success. Instead, it makes you a bit vulnerable to things falling apart or really going wrong. The diversity of different crops or plants allows each one to occupy a distinct space, one that supports the other ones, and you appreciate how every part has a purpose. I think our lives are kind of like that.
You aren't just one thing, and this is a good thing. This is a gift that we get to have so many different dimensions and sides to ourselves, and that those different parts of ourselves are meant to coexist, that there's supposed to be flow and synergy between each of them. I think the more we can make room for the ball to be passed between these different sides of ourselves, the more flexible we'll be with our expectations of ourselves. And when we start giving ourselves that grace, when we start accepting it, that opens up a lot of possibilities. And ultimately, it'll allow us to take more focus off of ourselves in a healthy way and to orient ourselves more around our connection to others.